Hey everybody, welcome to another Professionally Incorrect. I'm Liam Clisham, and today we're going to take a look at making circuitry lines inside Houdini using the Find Shortest Path SOP. It's a very easy setup. I'm expecting this to be a 5-10 minute tutorial at most. So let's go ahead and jump into Houdini. You all can probably pause this and figure out what to do at this point. There's so few steps involved. I think if you have used Houdini at any point, feel free to just pause this, take a look at the node tree here, and build it. You don't have to watch the rest of the video. However, if you're new to Houdini, I'm going to walk through these steps. We'll rebuild it from scratch. A quick overview is have a grid, group some points over here like so. If I select this, you'll see I've got that going on, and that's where all these lines are going to start from. I've got a labs random selection tool going here, which I need to turn on the color so you can see, but these are going to be where all the endpoints are. So start at the center here where we selected and then find the way to these points there. We'll get into what the cost does in a minute, but that basically drives the look and shape of the paths in there, but that's what our noise looks like. Like so. There's a turning cost, which we'll go over too in a little bit, just some more noise in there. And then find shortest path is basically the ultimate goal here. And then these extra two in here kind of reshape them a little bit. This is like a specialized resample is what I'm finding out as I play with it more. And then this is fusing it to go from 30,000 points down to 5,000 points because there's just so many extra points that it creates, but it makes a nice, cool shape. So that's the gist. If you're advanced, feel free to pause and stop and just leave me a thanks in the comment below. And let's rebuild this setup from scratch. Or actually, before we do that, I just want to show you what you can do too with another shape as well, just like so. All right, so that's that. So let's throw down a grid, be any size grid. And yeah, we can just leave it at 10 by 10 by 10. The one thing that I have found is you want to leave your connectivity in the upper four selections. Let me see if I can get that not so bright. There we go. So these first four first three, are basically going to give you the same thing when you get down to find shortest path. Not exactly, but it'll just basically be rows and columns. So there's no need to use that. But each of these is going to give you a different look. So triangles will give you a different look than quads will. Alternating triangles will give you a different look than reverse triangles and so on and so forth. So I think I'm going to leave it to alternating triangles to begin with, and we'll just leave these rows and divisions as is. And I'm going to throw down a find shortest path SOP over here and just connect it up already, and you'll see we get some errors, and what it's saying is there's no start points defined, no endpoints defined either. So that's what this group here is doing. So I'm going to go ahead and just copy this over like so. You can just create a new group SOP, and I've set mine up to have $OS up here, so it just picks up the name from down here, but we don't want it to be start two, so I'm going to rename this to start. And if we flag this, you'll see it's picking up these four points right there to start. So come back down here, hit start like so, and it doesn't do anything. And that's because we need to assign some endpoints. So you'll see there's no endpoints assigned. I think if we do any start to each end, nope. Oh, gotta put an asterisk there. So that defines everything as each end. There we go. So yeah, if we do any start to each end, which each end will now be defined as all the points on here, it'll start to connect these four points right here in the center going out. So you can see there's a point that starts here, and it's going to try and connect to all these. Point here tries to connect to all these, so on and so forth. But you can define your own endpoints and randomize them, or if you want to be really specific and art direct them, that's fine too. And you just need to set up another group, or if you even want to just come in and say, there, that's my endpoint, and it'll do that one. Or let's say these right there, and that's what you'll get. I'm going to go ahead and use this labs random selection because I like it and it helps visualize things. And you'll see I've already got this named as ends in here, so we can pipe that in later. But a quick walkthrough of this. So I turn on color selected and flag that. I think it starts on exact number. You can kind of just pick a ratio of how many points you want. So yeah, basically saying a percentage of points that you want to be selected at random and then turned into a group. You don't have to turn into a group. You can delete from selected, delete non-selected, like so. But for our purposes, we'll just turn it into a group called ends. And let's try, whoop, 0.3 is what I meant. Let's see what that looks like. And sure, that can be it. Definitely didn't mean to land on 69. Let's rotate that. Do 113. How about that? Okay. So then we'll come in here, hit ends, delete the rest of these out like so. And you'll see now it's trying to go from these start points here in the center all the way out. And I'm going to turn off my grid just so we can see these a little bit better. So how do we make this even cooler? Well, I think for our purposes, let's go ahead and up these to like 32 by 32 so we get some more lines in there. And that's already starting to look a little bit like a circuit board. But if I were to go down to quads, you'll see this is more straight lines. And if I go to triangles, straight with 45s, alternating triangles, almost like an L system in there. And then reverse triangles is just gonna be the reverse of the regular triangles. So yeah, I'll leave it at alternating triangles now. I think that's good, but I still want to have some more variation like we got in this version over here. So something the shortest path tool does is have these cost attributes. So if you check this max search, let's see if it will let me. Yes, there we go. I've had some weird hiccups with this in the viewport today, so that's why I was wondering if it would let me. But if drag this, it's almost like a chunky carve, and it's saying how much effort do you want to make to get to from the start points to the end points. So no effort, be lazy, put a little bit of effort in, more, 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 so on and so forth. But we can control this with some noise and make it be randomized throughout. And that's how we can get some of those cool, intricate patterns that we saw in the other one. So the way we do that is it's enable this point cost attribute. You can name it whatever you want. I like calling it cost because, you know, that's what we're doing, is controlling the cost. And I'm gonna do a noise float like this, pipe this in here, which is gonna be set to P scaled to begin with. And let me turn off the color here. And we'll just call this cost. And if you wanna see what it's doing, you can hit this little flag right there. And we can mess with the size in there like so. Come back down here and you'll see now we've got our cost and no more warning. So I'm going to turn this off, take a look at this, and kind of adjust this. And there we go. You can see we're starting to get different looks, and different noises will give us different effects too. So forth. So that's pretty good. Maybe some less octaves in there, but make it a little bit rougher. We could even do terrain too. Anyway, play with the noise all you want. I kind of want to see what happens if we make it even more intricate, like so. And bring down the roughness a bit. Maybe up this element size, like so. I can see we're starting to get like patches of areas in there. I think I'll go back up to Perlin, which I didn't really make too big of a difference. Alligator, that's kind of cool. All right, so we'll leave that like so. And there's one other cost attribute you can use. So this one controls how much energy it's using to go from one point to another. And there's another one down here called turning cost. And it's basically the same thing, but saying how much energy to make a turn towards another point. So I'm gonna go ahead and copy this, put it down here, change this to T cost or turning cost, whatever you want to name it. And then down here, put in T cost like so. And you'll see it already changed this. I'm going to go to Perlin again, change this down, and you'll see now we're getting a lot more 45 degree angles in some random spots. And you can up the amplitude and get some, like, I guess that's hatching going on or whatever, since we've got the grid in there. But yeah, I'm gonna set this back to 1, like so. But yeah, completely art directable at this point. You can kind of figure out, do I want any turning costs? I think this is starting to be like not so circuitry or circuit-like anymore. So I'm gonna turn that off now. What else? Omit distance to cost is kind of cool. What it does is it tries to not think about how far away the points are from the start points and just connect things as much as possible. So you see like this, everything gets its own individual line like a circuitry board, but this one will try and connect everything together. So let's say we've got a start point here and it comes down and it tries to go all the way here and connect. You'll see it goes all the way out to here until there's nowhere else to go. If we come back to that same start point, it'll go this way and then down here and really just keep trying to connect to everything. So sort of, I guess the best way to think about it is like an infection solver where it's going to just try and connect to everything as best as possible. I know that's not exactly right to compare it to an infection solver, but it's kind of the same idea of, okay, spread, just keep spreading until you can't, or until something else has already consumed that area. But for this purpose, since we're doing circuitry lines, we'll do that. All right, so now comes some cool little finessing. I'm not actually gonna copy this time. I'm gonna go ahead and do a polyspline fresh, like so. And when we put this on here, you'll see it starts to basically act like a resample or like a subdivision and smooth these out. It's initially set to Bezier and you can add or take away divisions. So it's a little bit more straight and it gets more curvy. This will control the, what's it called? control vertices, that's what CV. So the first control vertice, last control vertice, so on and so forth. So it starts to extend these a bit or reshape some a bit too. I have found 3 and 3 works pretty well with all of them. And let's see, special Bezier gets a little bit more curvy. Smooth gets like some cool wavy snake-like things in there. I really like the 2-degree Bezier. It leaves some nice sharp turns, but also gets like some organic curves in there too. And if I bring these back, so there we go. I think that's a good happy medium. The only downside, and I talked about this real quick in the beginning, is it does make a lot more points. So originally we're at 19,000 and this brings it up to 115,000. So it's a lot. And that's where our friend the fuse comes in handy, which my alt drag did not drag and copy. There we go. And we just throw that down like so. Default setting should be fine, but you might want to turn down the snap distance, and this brings it down to 17,000. So even less than what our shortest path was to begin with. And that's basically it. You can have fun with it now. You can throw down a carve and make it grow. So if I come in here, flag that, and we don't want our first, but our second, we can have this grow out like that. You can control this with a fall off if you do some promotion type stuff. I've found that it doesn't always execute the way that I expect. So the way that I've gone about animating it is by doing MOPS shape fall offs and an infection solver. So I'm just gonna go ahead and copy these over here, but you can use any kind of fall off that Houdini has. I've gone over it multiple times in other videos, so just go ahead and search my channel to see different ways of using falloffs. But this one is just setting a start position in here. If I hit preview, you'll see these tips are now selected for this infection solver down here. This is part of MOPS Plus, so you'll have to subscribe to get it. But if I do a preview and hit play, you'll see we now get this growth on there. It can export the falloff to Redshift, Karma, Octane, wherever you are, and kind of have this be a reveal based on alpha or whatever you want. So that's it. That's how you make circuitry lines or cool other lines inside of Houdini using noise to control the fine shortest path. If you like this video, please give it a like. It helps my channel out and the algorithm out so other Houdini users can find these videos. Subscribing is always great too, but I don't blame you if you don't subscribe. The likes are what get me. All right, thanks everybody, and I'll see you in the next one, hopefully in a week or two. Bye.